Well, thank you much. It's interesting to be back aboard after 20 years or so. On behalf of myself and there are some other folks up front here, we appreciate you hosting us and having us out for what's the 77th anniversary of what now is called the Panama City Division of the Naval Surface Warfare Center, correct? What I wanted to do today is talk a little bit about how the lab came here. Just a little bit of background. I came here in 1963, so the things I'm going to talk about here are not eyewitness accounts, okay, for any of us that are visiting here today. But what I did want to say is that when I came here, and I think some of the others came here that are visiting with us, the organization was known as the Mine Defense Laboratory. There were about 600 people here, maybe a little less than that at that time. There were two mission areas, mine countermeasures and torpedo countermeasures. And toward the end here, I want to talk just a little bit about how the mission areas evolved over the ensuing years. But the time frame that I really wanted to talk to and that I was interested in, became interested in primarily after I retired, although it got started off by some other things that happened early on. Time frame I wanted to talk about is from about 1942 to about 1955. And the lab really identifies its starting point. And I call it the laboratory because that's what it was when I came here. It was called the Mine Defense Laboratory. So when I say laboratory, I mean the organization that's here today that's known as Panama City Division. When I came here, it was probably mid-career before I began to realize that the people that we worked around here had actually founded the lab about 18 years before we came here, 20 years before. And there was very little, over the years, the information pretty much, I think, got lost of who those folks were and what they'd done. So there are two things I wanted to talk about. And one is how the laboratory came to be located here. And there's some history behind that that goes back to 1942 in the closing, or not in the close, but in World War II. And then what I want to do is just mention some of the people who were typical of the folks who actually got the lab kicked off. I think it's an interesting story. I hope you find it to be an interesting story also. So those are the things that I wanted to mention to you. I need to tell you what my sources were, since I didn't have any firsthand knowledge of this. I knew some of us knew the folks that helped to found it. Okay, they were basically people came through World War II, came through the Depression. The World War II veterans that helped found this, if you know anything about World War II people, they got things done in a hurry. Okay, they did not particularly get tied up in some of the red tape that you might see today to get things done. There was one story about one of the guys that came here early. Somebody told him to go clear 2 or 3 acres of land out here between the what was then building 110 and the Air Force or the Thomas Drive. He grabbed a bulldozer, a couple of three people and some chainsaws, and within a week or so cleared 2 acres of land or something for storage of the stuff coming down. But I wanted to acknowledge where I got the information here. Primary source was the Underseer. The Underseer was a newspaper, and there are some bound copies over here if you want to look at them. The Underseer was a newspaper that was published in-house by the laboratory several times a month from 1955 to 1992. There were about 800 issues published. Luckily, we had those scanned in the 1990s sometime, and those became one of the primary sources. Within that, there were a series of articles, about 9 articles, that a lady by the name of Catherine Clark, Kitty Clark, many of us remember Kitty, very energetic lady, She was in the public affairs office and was designated as the lab historian during that time. And she wrote about 9 or 10 articles, which began in 19 on about the 35th, 40th anniversary, that traced it, the history of the lab. I've used those as a primary source for a lot of the information of how the lab came to be here. There was a fellow by the name of Harold Johnson who actually was the first civilian employee of the laboratory, came here in August of 45. In 1961, he wrote a little summary report. Never got published. It's never completely finished, but it had all the initial data in it about how the lab started. About 2002, we got a package in from a guy named W.D. Kastner. W.D. Kastner had been in the public affairs office here in 1955, and what he did was he had written a little summary of the lab's early years. It was a James C. Wright is another person I'll talk about, gave a presentation of the Panama City Historical Society that was a source of information. We gathered a lot of this up about 2005, put it in the little book, The Early History of the Lab. And of course, there were some newspaper articles. So those are my sources, okay? What went on here? What I want to do is tell this story in two pieces about how the lab came here. And there are two aspects to it. The one on the left-hand side, in the light blue, is what happened before the lab came here. The right-hand side is an event or a laboratory that was established in Solomons, Maryland, that had a functional transfer to the geographic site here in 1945. What I want to do is talk about those. And one of the people I want to talk about here in a minute is a guy that I think really we ought to recognize as the father of the laboratory. Okay. Everybody knows the area we're talking about. It's about 370 acres when it was first acquired, stretching from 98 down to past Alligator Bayou. The parcel of land itself was acquired in 1942 by what the government called condemnation procedures. It was acquired for part of the war effort, World War II effort. And there were a number of sites that were acquired across the Gulf Coast and other coastal areas for coastal defense. What they called it was a section base to support ships operating in the Gulf or around the coastal areas. The section base was acquired specifically to support the World War II effort. And here's how it came to be. It was a parcel of land that was owned by a group of businessmen. It was undeveloped. The government acquired it by the so-called condemnation procedures. It became a section base in April of 43. The primary mission of it was to support warships and operations in the Gulf. Okay, there was a submarine threat. There was the supposed threat of potentially invasion. So it was set up to support the warships in the Gulf. The general type of things it did, it had general ship stores, keep the ships supplied, the place they could come into. It had a dispersing, an engineering for minor repairs, communications, ship manuals, medical, ammunition storage. Some of the old bunkers, I think, are still around for the ammunition storage areas. The medical part of it was an interesting part because most of the areas where these were located were rural areas where they had very limited medical facilities. So that one of the portions of the government, one of the things that they did is provide medical support to the surrounding area. The area was described as 300 something acres that it's 370 acres that they have acquired. It was described in a report early on as approximately 27 hutments, not buildings, but hutments, located almost totally on the south end of the site, down in this area where we're at today. A large portion of the area, like 370 acres, was not in actual use. So this was a large area. But by mid-1944, the need for the section base began to dwindle. It was actually gone because of the war. The Battle of the Atlantic was being won. There was practically no more threat to the U.S. And the property continued to be owned by the Navy or the government, but it wasn't in use. Well, in parallel with the time that they were establishing the suction base, there were contracts being let by the Navy for amphibious support ships, namely the LSTs. Most of the LSTs were being constructed in shipyards that were inland, and the LSTs were brought into the Gulf and then into the Chesapeake area, Bay area, for training purposes. There were approximately 19 shipyards in the country building ships during World War II, okay? Tremendous number of ships built, but the contract was for 490 LSTs. A lot of those LSTs came here to what was called the amphibious training base, which was established on section base property, particularly for the purpose of training the crews to drive. And people that trained here drove landing ships across beaches in Europe, Normandy, in the Pacific, which you've all heard about. An interesting part of it was that they had what they called an informal agreement with the paper mill over in the Millville area, that they could use their dock for practice and docking of the LSTs, with one little slight provision: the Navy had to repair any damage, okay, that was done to the docks. The first permanent building was actually built on this area to support the amphibious training base, and it was built in what eventually became Building 1. I think the building we're in today is 581. So it became Building 1. Building 1 was both a barracks and an administration building. It persisted as one of the buildings here used up until the late 60s, probably 1970s. The front gate at that time was located right across from where the Woodlawn entrance, where the stoplight for Woodlawn is now. It remained there up until the construction of the overpass and all that, and it was shifted over to the back. And there was a dock that was here. It was a wooden dock. And all of this played, the availability, you're going to see in a minute, the availability of space, the harbor area, the dock, and most importantly, the environment that we have here played as the major factors in why the lab was located here eventually. In 1945, the training and operations had gone away. They had ceased, and it was put into what they called a caretaker status. Government still owned the land. So that the land was acquired then through the condemnation procedures, became section base, became an amphibious training base. It's in Bay. Second part of the story. Where did the functional piece come from that was here? And the functional piece came from some work that was done early in World War II. The Navy mines were a real factor in mine warfare, or in warfare in World War II. The Navy established a place up in Solomons, Maryland, known as the Naval Mine Warfare Test Station. And it was stipulated that it would be near Washington, D.C. That was one of the stipulations for testing mine sweeping gear. The organization that is now known as NAVC was known evidently then as the Bureau of Ships, BUE Ships. You'll see that referred to here quite a few times. Within BUE Ships is where the Mine Countermeasures organization that managed the acquisition and the development of mine countermeasures gear during the war was located. They hired a gentleman by the name of Thomas Frost in 1942. And I want to talk about this guy Frost a minute. Thomas Frost was a reserve Navy lieutenant commander when World War II started. He was called to active duty. And at the time he was called to active duty, he was a physics professor at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Okay. He was called to duty, stationed, assigned to the mine countermeasures group, and he was given the task of establishing the mine warfare test station at Solomons, Maryland. He's going, you're going to see his name appear several times here. And if I had to look back and say who was the father of the installation that's now NSA and that, it's Commander Frost. Okay, he became the primary sponsor and the advocate and really kept the place alive, it appears, for about the first 10 years that it existed. You're going to see his name crop up a little bit. By 1945, the organization he started in that was established in 43 employed 150 people, both combined military and civilian population. What had happened during World War II was that mine warfare had changed significantly. It went from where you had the threat was basically MRD mines, to where the threat was acoustic magnetic pressure mines. And pressure mines was a big deal to the people, as you'll see here in a minute, eventually. The emergence of the acoustic magnetic pressure mine type things convinced the Navy, the mine countermeasures and view ships, they needed a site to be able to continuously pursue mine countermeasure development, research and development efforts. And who would get the job of establishing this, quote, new mine countermeasures research and development, but Thomas Frost, okay? He had established the Naval Mine Warfare Test Station. And then toward the end of the 1940s, it was realized that the base in Solomons, Maryland had some significant operating problems. Not operating, but in mostly environmental problems. And that there were some limitations to it that really prevented it from being used as a long-term R&D organization for mine countermeasures. One was the high volume, the two that get pointed out most are the high volume of traffic that in the area where they were trying to operate, and the hydrographic nature of the environment. It was practically all mud bottom, okay? NAV C, or at that time called Buse Ships, initiated a study to look at sites around the country that were either being taken out of, either closing down completely or being put in caretaker status to be used as a site for the new R&D laboratory that NAV C or Buse Ships wanted to establish. They made a survey of these of the sites that they could potentially use. Commander Frost was given the responsibility to go find the site and to put it in place. And two sites came out of that, both of them in Florida. One was a Navy operating base in Key West. The other was the amphibious training base site that was located here. They put together an inspection team to come out. And that site survey team consisted of three people that came here in either late 1944 or early 1945. Commander Frost, a gentleman called Commander McElreath, and then a Lieutenant Commander Jerome Freeman. And Freeman's name will come up again because he became the second commanding officer of the laboratory eventually. Well, obviously the Panama City site was their selected site, and I'm sure that most people are familiar with why the laboratory is located here today. If you tie it back to the mine countermeasures business, that one was the environment, the hydrographic environment was ideal for mine countermeasures work. It had a minimum back in 1945. There was a minimum of commercial traffic There was a minimum of any kind of traffic, as a matter of fact, in Panama City, I understand. The climate was favorable for year-round operations. The docks and the facilities in the harbor of protected harbor were really assets to it, had convenient access to the Gulf. And the land area was probably one of the, not only the environment, but one of the providing, one of the dominating factors over Key West. You got 370 acres of land here to expand on, to work with. So on July the 20th of 1945, the Secretary of Navy, who was James Forrestal at the time, sent a letter out that says, the facilities of the former U.S. Naval Amphibious Training Base, St. Andrews Bay, Panama City, are hereby established under a commanding officer to be designated as a U.S. Navy mine countermeasure station. Second person, I see Leon smiling here, second person that was really fundamental to this lab was Congressman Bob Sykes. Okay, Bob Sykes, if I'm not mistaken, his district also included not only Tyndall and here, but it included, I think, Eglin at the time, okay, a large district.
I think he might have gone all the way to Pensacola.
All the way to Pensacola. So he had a large congressional district. Bob Sykes took great pride in making sure that the military installations had the facilities that they needed, okay? And it did not hurt that he was eventually became, I believe, the chairman of the House Appropriations Committee. So he came here numerous times for ribbon cuttings, groundbreaking ceremonies, dedication of the ocean simulation facility, and other places. But his office was the first to announce that they were going to transfer from the Solomons, Maryland, transfer the functional responsibilities and the people and the equipment up there to the Panama City site. In August of 45, the newspaper, if you go back and look up the newspaper, it carried a headline, which is shown here on the right, that they were going to establish a research station here, and that there would be 30 officers and 150 enlisted persons. And some of these numbers are mind-boggling to me, knowing what things cost now. They issued a $35,000 contract for renovation, and most of the renovation was around making sure that building one was sufficient, the docks were sufficient, and those type things. Commander Frost was in charge of putting all this together. As I had said, he became the major advocate and funding sponsor of the station during what was called the station then. But he had a dual, he had the dual staffing approach. The military was responsible for the base operations and for the, like it is now, I'm sure, and for the ships. Civilian workforce was to be established that would be responsible for the technical research and development work. Getting the military people transferred here was no real obstacle to you cut orders and sent them down. So the first contingent of people that arrived here were these, was the military contingent. The civilian contingent was a different matter. You had to hire those people, okay? So Frost is faced with the problem of hiring the initial technical folks to manage, to conduct the R&D work. The first elements of the military transfer began arriving in early July. They actually began before the announcement came out that the lab was going to be here. So they began to arrive in 1945, in 1 July. And the formal commissioning took place in 1 September of 45. And Frost then began recruiting his workforce. And he was very active in that. And there was a civilian component at the station in Solomons, Maryland. Now there were, he brought a lot, there were a lot of people in. I'll show you some of the statistics of the growth very quickly in a few moments. These are four guys that were, four men that were here when most of us remember, or some of us, Leon and I remember, okay. Me and Leon remember these guys. Leon and I remember these folks. Harold Johnson was the first civilian employee. He was the first one that he came from Solomons, and he was the first one that Frost convinced to move down here. And I'll tell you a little bit more about him. He arrived on the 10th of August. His family arrived the 9th. He came to work on the 10th. He had a long career here. He was very active in the mine countermeasures development work. He was the guy that established the first initial NATO and technical cooperation panel and foreign relations, or the foreign things. But Harold had a long career, retired in 1969. A second guy that was important to the startup was a fellow by the name of Raymond Kelly. He was the first engineer that came aboard the laboratory, arriving also in August of 45. Very much became a head of one of the engineering departments here eventually, and he retired in 1980. Hal Lubnow arrived as a Lieutenant JG. He was one of the folks that they transferred by military reassignment. After he was separated, he joined the civilian force. He became one of the heads in the mine countermeasures work. And then Jane Seawright, who arrived in January of 46. Seawright eventually became the head of what became warfare analysis of the operations research folks here at the laboratory. Now, just pick out these four. There were numerous people, but there was a real effort to recruit folks. And I wanted to give you a couple of the reflections that some of these people had about what it was like when they first came here. We have mentioned that Frost came in, or that Johnson was the first employee. In 1985, they had Catherine Clark, arrange what they called a Founders Day reunion. And there were a group of people that came back here, most military, many military, and some civilians. And this is the way in 40 years after he came here that Frost remembered how things went. He said, Panama City was isolated away from towns of any size. There were no educational facilities past Bay High, and no hospital except something called Adams Clinic. Bay Memorial Hospital, now Sacred Heart, was established in 1949. So the is what he's referring to there. And he talks about Commander Frost. Commander Frost did a masterful selling job. He promised salaries would be good. He said that he knew that mine warfare was here to stay one way or the other. And a subsequent events through the 1990s showed that was true. And we'll talk about some of those here in a moment. He packed up his family, one in the first grade, one in the fifth, and came here arriving on the 9th of August in 45. The shipyard that he's referring to that closed 24 hours after he came here was located, as you, I'm sure most of you are aware, at Port Panama City. And during the war, they built Liberty ships. They built like 108 Liberty ships over there during the war. It closed, which meant that there were a lot of people leaving town, or a lot of people looking for jobs after that. Made a good recruitment environment. Laboratory areas had to be set up, instruments and equipment inventory. All this stuff was coming down from Solomons, Maryland. So it was the first group. And what Frost, he goes on to say that Frost told me to get the first significant project going so that the people in Washington would know this was serious business. Okay, the first project that was established was one called Asymmetrical Diamond, founded in one of the lab notebooks years later. Okay, it was actually a magnetic sweep where that he later described it as the first experimental data to confirm the theoretical studies on magnetic fields produced by currents distributed through the seawater and the sea bottom. And you have to remember that mine sweeping as a, to sweep influence mines was something that was just emerging then. Okay, it was not, they were developing the original techniques. The second guy that I wanted to mention that came back for the 40th Founders Day reunion in 85 was this fellow Jerome Freeman. He was the second CO of the lab, and he recalled it that some interesting facts about my wife and I lived in a two-room cluster home out on Panama City Beach. Okay, there was nothing out there then. Didn't have gas, no air conditioning, no gas stoves. Had oil heating. If you were here years ago, you'll remember what oil heating was. Interesting units, to say the least. And the end of the war meant that many bases were being deactivated. And he identifies a fellow here by the name of Tony Bach, who was one of those that was transferred down. Tony Bach was the kind of the maintenance and building guy. And they sent Tony out on a search and procurement mission to places that were closing to gather up surplus material. And years later, after this, Frost, or a few years after this, Freeman eventually said he did an excellent job. Said the amount of material that came in was overwhelming. They would never use all of it, but all prefab buildings, heavy equipment, all of that initially came from surplus, what did not come from up north. To give you an indication of how well developed the area was, his last paragraph he added the business, there was no range law, which meant cattle could roam around without fences, okay? There were actually, so this was actually an undeveloped area. Nowadays, it's kind of mind-boggling to me of the amount of things that are located here. A permanent status was approved for the laboratory in February of 46. And at the end of 46, the station employed a complement of 15 technical employees, 25 other employees. And between 1945 and 1950, they were successful in recruiting a workforce that numbered 265 in the civilian side, plus 96 military were here, of which there were 7 officers in 89. These two pictures came out of one of the early laboratory command histories. The engineering division, I'm not sure of the date here, but it's about 1947. Engineering division was where the 7 people pictured here. Thomas, Ackerman, Kelly, Van de Erve, Cozy, Bird, and Gould. Cozy eventually became a department head here. Ray Kelly became a department head here. And we'll talk about Gould here in a moment. The research division was interesting. 6 people. Dr. Julius Hageman, a fellow by the name of Harry O'Neill, John Farrell, Harold Johnson, Howard Naseth, and Robert Wheeler. The guy I'm going to say a little bit about Hageman here in a minute because his is an interesting story. Harry O'Neill became the second technical director here. Johnson obviously became important. Naseth became head of an engineering division department here eventually in the 60s. Robert Wheeler eventually became the head of the torpedo countermeasures group. Remember I mentioned there were 2 groups. There was a mine countermeasures group when we were first established and a torpedo countermeasures. And I'm going to talk a little bit about what happened in some of that in a few moments. Leon is smiling. We'll talk to it in a little bit. Well, these were the folks. What I want to do is tell you a little bit about Julius Hageman. It's an interesting story. Upper left, he immigrated here from Germany at the end of World War II. He was a German scientist. He had actually developed the German magnetic sensor that was used in the German mines during World War II. Operation Paperclip was described as an opportunity for people who worked in the technical sector in Germany to immigrate to the United States and work for the U.S. He took advantage of that, brought his whole family over. They grew up here. He became a naturalized citizen, was the inventor of what was called shadowgraph, which was one of the first really good mine hunting sonars, towed, side scan type. It wasn't the side scan in the later, but it became the first towed sonar that had a good capability to detect things on the bottom. And it was used, I don't know what the status is now. It was actually used by hydrographic surveys by the ONR for years. He eventually became head of the mine hunting division here. First technical director came in 1947, was recruited here. He was a fellow by the name of Ken Sherman, came from Carnegie Institute, formerly of ONR. He became important. He was very instrumental in helping to get Gulf Coast Community College started. There's actually a building that in the 60s, one of the first buildings was named after Ken Sherman. Over that same period, we had a number. The first commanding officer was a captain. The first captain was Captain me. Then we had a couple of commanders, and starting with Captain Brown in 1947, we've had mostly captains ever since that were the commanding officers. Captain Fowler was the commanding officer during World War II, or not World War II, the Korean episode, okay. Korean War episode was pretty much a defining moment in getting the laboratory on a really firm basis. If you remember your history, you know, the war started in 1950 with the North Koreans invading South Korea. They proceeded all the way south into South Korea. There was an amphibious landing at Incheon, which is very famous for cutting off, reversing the tide of the war that back. There was a second landing planned on the opposite coast of Korea at a place called Wonsan. And that, when the amphibious forces arrived there, they found out this place was heavily mined with a large mixed minefield. A mixed minefield of MURD and magnetic influence mines. Right out of the bat on the minesweeping operations, two U.S. minesweepers were lost. Okay. A few days later, a South Korean minesweeper was lost with a lot of folks lost. Well, as soon as all this happened, the call came back to this new laboratory here that you're the experts in mine warfare, come over. And so there were four people that were deployed to serve on site with Mine Run 3 and some of the other staffs. And the four people were Howard Naseth, who was a pressure mine sweeping guy, John Farrell, who was one of the, all these were out of the research group, Harold Johnson, and a fellow named Jim Goo. So they wound up spending several weeks on the staff of the mine warfare people over in Korea. The impact of all that was really significant from the lab's point of view. It was then that a funding increase, infrastructure, authorization for new people and for the growth and for construction and upgrade of existing equipments or existing facilities became. Mine Division 46 was home ported here, supported. As you can see from the picture, the dock facility was wooden docks, okay, at that time. And the lab experiences, you see a significant growth in people. It went from about 225, 30 people in 1950 to a little over 600 people by 1955. By 1955, it was 627 civilians, 296 military, 28 officers, 268 enlisted men. I threw these in just as a view of what it was like. The top one is a 1949-ish picture. The long building right up in the very foreground, flat top building, is building one, which stood not very far from here, right near here. It was used for many years. The remainder of the buildings were temporary, and the ones that in the area that were white looking top buildings in the photographs were some of the prefab buildings that Tony Bach went out and procured from other organizations that were happy to get rid of the material. The gate, again, was located. And in the lower left there, there's an interesting picture. That's the Thomas Drive, the northwest corner out here. That's Thomas Drive and Highway 98, where the overpass is now. There are some other pictures from that area that were era that were interesting. But by 1953, you see a top view there, view of the laboratory. This is the area that we refer to it as the industrial area, which is this area back in here. And the 1955 annual report cited a number of technical accomplishments, obviously the Korean War. Some others were that I've highlighted there, the Rotovac, which was an acoustic sweeping device, helicopters. They were used in Korea to spot mines visually. It was a small step to say, well, how could they be used for sweeping mines? And helicopters during the 60s and 70s, even up into the 80s, became a mainstay in the mine sweeping world. You see, diver work began with the scuba gear. XMAP was a large pressure mines. Pressure mines were a big deal back in that time period. Torpedo countermeasures was working on the acoustic torpedoes, both towed and expendable decoys for countering torpedoes. Torpedoes were also evolving from straight runners to homing torpedoes. And the Project General was a major project here on torpedo countermeasures, which was set up to physically destroy torpedoes. Simulators were coming online. Simulation became a big deal, particularly in the torpedo countermeasures area in the 1960s and 70s. A variety of other things that were going on, most concerning mine countermeasures there. Some of the old photographs are interesting. I'm just going to run through a couple of these real quick. The top one there on the top half is something that was called the hydro. That was a pressure mine sweeping. That involved a wing 50 feet in length, 20-foot cord, 2-foot thickness, towed at a slight angle, could be put together to make 100-foot, produces pressure signature for sweeping pressure mine. Now that was a cumbersome device, okay? There's an interesting point to be made on the photograph on the right up there. You see the pontoons that supported it. The towing tensions must have been horrendous on this. Look at all the people on the back of the minesweeper that's towing it. Nobody's got a head above the rails, okay, as they're beginning to pick up the tow. There's another interesting aspect of that system. If you notice the floats, in the 1960s, they had another use. They became the first, couple of those became the first habitat for the Sea Lab Man in the Sea program, okay, was fashioned after that, which is another story, very interesting story in itself. The bottom was shows the Project General, which was a major development during the 1950s. Torpedoes were straight runners. Project General was designed to tow a series of segments alongside primarily protection of merchant ships. Each section in the streamer along each side had an explosive charge and a detector in it, so the torpedo crossing that streamer tripped it and it went to a very high state of development. I mean, they towed this system for weeks at a time to simulate an Atlantic crossing, which was a real concern then. Helicopter minesweeping began to emerge about 1952. And you got to remember what they began with. They began with whatever helicopters were there. And it's interesting to look at the evolution of it. And all of that work took place here. they eventually, by 1962, had a system that was actually went into the fleet, and they had formed Helicopter Squadron 6, which was stationed up in Norfolk. All of the work that went into developing the airborne mine countermeasures was done here. Okay, and that was the first real test of airborne mine countermeasures was the cleanup after the Vietnam War, which was significant. The other two projects there were, or a couple of projects that had been mine countermeasure projects. But in 1955, the lab celebrated its first anniversary. Laid a cornerstone. Bob Sykes laid this cornerstone, building 110. Number of the folks that were there were recognized as plank holders. These were people that came to work between 1 July and 45 and 1 July 46. Most of these folks were still here when I came here. They were talking to them with some of the people that gave me a little bit of interest in the history of the lab. Quite a assortment of folks, and this was across the whole, this was the civilian structure that was there. These folks were very instrumental into getting the lab kicked off. There was a military component of it, which was not shown. That was the previous two slides were civilian. There was a military component. That these were folks that came back to the 40th Founders Reunion. Jerome Friedman up in the top left there was the second commanding officer. This fellow Tony Bott here was the fellow that went out and collected all the material that got the lab. These folks all came back, and Kitty Clark actually interviewed all of them, and their data around that shows how they remembered the starting of the lab. By 1955, the lab looked like this. These buildings on the lower right here were the principal, together with old building one you see there, were the admin buildings and where the technical folks were located in the temporary buildings of building 51, 52, two of those. I think there's only about one of these buildings that's left now. Everything else is gone, but it was a wide open spaces, and it was all utilized, had a nice beach, all gone now, okay, but well utilized, I'm sure. What I want to do is very quickly run through what happened after 55. The critical events that have really been drivers in the lab were after the Korean War, Vietnam War, the lab was heavily involved in sending advisors over to Vietnam, 40-something people. Cleaning up the U.S. laid some 11,000 mines in Vietnam during the Vietnam War. Part of the protocol for the peace accord was we would clear the mines. So there was a large task force that went over the unit. The lab actually earned a meritorious unit commendation for that. As you see, the civilian population stayed, civilian personnel after 1955 stayed 600, about 600 up until the Reagan buildup. Between, and in a very few years there, it doubled. And I understand it's about that now, maybe a little more number of people here at the lab. Desert Storm was a big deal with the laboratory. There were ships, if you remember the Persian Gulf, this is in recent history. Number of ships suffered mine strikes. Mines are a very useful weapon to countries that don't want to invest a whole lot in military. They will most probably occur again. The BRAC, things referred to there as BRAC, or the base realignment and closure actions, which were mandated by Congress in the 1990s. The lab gained one thing, and gained the mine development, which I understand has since diminished in effort, but it gained also the mine countermeasure ships, ISEA work at that time. The downside of BRAC was the lab lost the torpedo countermeasures work, and the torpedo countermeasures work was a quarter of the total obligation authority of the laboratory at that time. It's interesting that the function went away, but most of the people did not, because of the fact, Leon tells me two people went with the work when it was transferred to another lab. The reason being is Desert Storm and Desert Shield were partially responsible for plus enough money here, the people were distributed across and the laboratory. And you can see on the bottom how the mission areas evolved over the years, okay? Spec war became a major mission area. Dive and life support's a real anchor here as far as infrastructure. The Marine Corps work, Marine Corps work, landmine countermeasures came here in the mid-60s, early 70s. The LCAC trials unit came from Carter Rock. It was sent here as a trials unit, and eventually, although it became, if you roll that and the amphibious warfare and the mine countermeasure stuff, I think you now call it expeditionary warfare. All total, all of these areas have something in common, and there's a lot of synergism between there as you move into the using remote vehicles and those type things, which I'm sure the research people are well into nowadays. But this was a snapshot of what happened after. And what I have tried to do in a few minutes here is give you some idea of how, one, how the lab came to be here. Came to be here through the circumstances of the section base, the amphibious training base, and the transfer of the people and the facilities from up in Solomon's Mirror. I still say there should be a plaque, a historical marker, something around here that recognizes Thomas Frost as the kind of the father of the lab. If it hadn't have been for Frost pushing this, it would have turned out differently. And I would hope that this gives you a little bit of appreciation for how the lab came here, who some of these people were. They were a group of people that, a lot of us benefited from their work. The Navy has benefited from their work. Lots of products have gone out of the lab here to it. And that's my nickel as far as how the lab came here and who some of the people were. For all of those of you that are viewing online, we appreciate your participation. For all of you that are here, I appreciate you coming.